mostly you're probably seeing it on the streets or seeing the Facebook page or whatever. So just a couple of things we got housekeeping. So that anybody needs to go to the toilet, men's, disabled ladies, and if the fire alarm goes off, just straight down, like, just 1 to 3 minutes. It's pretty basic stuff. So, yeah, you're not here to listen to me. I just want to, this man here has dedicated his entire life to animal rights and speaking up for those who have no voice. He's pretty fearless in his approach. And, I mean, he's just pretty much given up ever before the animals. So, just help me and welcome him.
Joey Carbstrong, that's my YouTube name. My actual name is Joey Armstrong. Carbstrong's a play on words. Carbohydrates are predominantly vegan. So, first of all, I want everyone to put their hands up. Who's already vegan? Okay. Who's coming to my fearless activism talk? I'll have another talk. Any of you coming to that?
When?
Tomorrow.
So there's another talk tomorrow, fearless activism. Who's coming to that? Okay, so most of you won't be there for that. Okay, so usually I do a couple of different talks, either directed at non-vegans or directed at vegans or directed at activists, okay? Now, this one here, I thought there might be some non-vegans present, so I thought I might just do a little something a little different, talk about my life story and talk about the importance of being vegan, but I also do a little bit for the vegans as well. Okay, so I thought I'd mix it up. Tomorrow night will be strictly an activist workshop. That's what we'll be focusing completely on. Alright, but, you know, I like people going from not being vegan to going straight into being an activist. That's what I think, that's where it's at. But I always start my talks with my life story. It's an integral part of who I am. I haven't always been, you know, this compassionate, cared about animals, cared about the plight of the environment, about the world. I didn't care about much. But I'll tell you a little story, and it come back to me when I was cleared my mind and I became vegan. So I was about 5 years old, and it was Christmas morning, and my little brother was playing out the back, and he was playing close to some ants. And I tried to stop him from stepping on the ants. I said, "Josh, you know, be careful, don't step on those ants, you might kill them, it's Christmas morning." I didn't want to see the ants get hurt on Christmas. So even as a young child, you know, something as insignificant in many people's eyes as a little ant, you know, I had compassion for, I had awareness of. And it's interesting how somewhere along the line it was programmed into me. That eating a piece of a cow that had been bolt gunned in the head, probably suffered their whole life, was okay to do. And later on, conditioned to gang violence. And I talk about the environment that shapes you. If you showed a child a slaughterhouse, they would not think that that's food, okay? And children are as close to their natural human nature as you can get. So where it all started for me is where I went wrong in life. I started going down the wrong track around 14, 15 years old. I started experimenting with substance abuse. Okay, I started using substances here and there. I found solitude in substances, marijuana and alcohol at the start. And also found people who I thought were like me. So, you know, some youths who would shave their heads. We used to hang out, a little crew of us. We'd get drunk, we'd go out to parties, we'd gatecrash parties, we'd get into fights. And this is how it started. This is how the violence started. Because your environment begins to shape you. If I took any of you out of this environment, put you in a really harsh environment, after a while you become conditioned to violence quite quickly. And that's what happened to me. I talk about two wolves. It's actually an Indian proverb. You have two wolves, a negative wolf and a positive wolf. And the one that survives is the one that you feed the most. Okay, I was feeding that negative wolf, and it turned into a monster. So I always had compassion in my heart. Okay, you remember from when I was a child, I always had that compassion, but it was clouded. Clouded by the environment I was in, the people I was surrounding myself with, and the substances. Okay? So where did it progress to? Obviously, it spirals out of control, doesn't it? I've progressed to drug dealing, heavy drug use, obviously using lots of drugs and being in a hectic environment like that starts to play on your mental state. So I suffered from mental issues, anxiety, depression. Spent some time in a hospital, okay, for, you know, mental issues. Many things happened to me in this environment. I've been beaten up, I've been run over, I've been bashed with bottles. But one significant thing happened to me when I did get run over, and I'll talk to you a little bit about that. I had an epiphany. So what happened that night is I was in an angry mood, I had a fight with my girlfriend, I was drinking alcohol and went out with some friends. This was around 10 years ago, 11 years ago. And we come to a bar, where there was another gang out the front of the bar. They were drunk too, quite aggressive and angry, just like we were. And I started a fight that night that could have been avoided. Okay, so I walked up, got a bit smart, and kicked off. Okay, I got punched in the face, and then it was just a really big fight. Turned out really violent, a really bloody fight, and there was lots of people that got seriously hurt. Okay, they hopped in their car, okay, we walked off, and they drove past us and nearly ran me over. Okay, I thought they'd gone. They hadn't gone. They circled around the back of the bar, come back, and came flying back through the car park. Okay, really fast. I didn't have time to move out the way. Both my friends went that way, and I got caught in the middle. And I jumped up right at the last moment. I got hit. I don't know if anyone's ever had a near-death experience, but everything slows down. Your life flashes before your eyes. And in that moment, I thought, wow, my actions have reactions. I've caused this. I've got what I asked for. So in that moment, I thought, I'm dead. I've died because of something silly, going out with a bad attitude, starting a fight, and I've lost my life now. And this all felt like an eternity, but you know, I was only a few minutes in the air flying, bang. I didn't die, luckily. I was walking within a week. I was pretty banged up, but no broken bones. It's crazy. Mum always says someone's looking out for you. Maybe they had bigger plans for me. But you know, did I learn my lesson from that? A little bit. You know, I had this epiphany. Wow, my actions have reactions and karma and all that. But did it stop me? No. Didn't stop me. I needed to learn the hard way. And I made many mistakes and I didn't learn from them straight away. But obviously the alcohol spiraled out of control. The drugs kept spiraling out of control. And I remember one day I backed myself into a corner. I thought, you know, I'd created all these problems around me. And I thought, okay, I've got a way out of this. So I was sitting on the end of my girlfriend's bed at the time. I always had a firearm down my pants and I found a way out. So I stuck the firearm inside my mouth and I thought, okay, I can pull the trigger here and end all my problems. But luckily I didn't. I held back and I realized that suicide is the permanent solution to a temporary problem. So if you keep holding on and firing through it, you know, you never know what can happen. I'll never have this chance now that I can spread my light and help people and help animals. What ended up happening is the gangs turned organised. It started off with small street gangs and it ended up turning into a high level of organised crime, and that's when it gets dangerous, okay? Something you say, something you can do, can get you killed, have your legs broken, and this happened a lot. Where it all come to a head for me was getting busted. I got busted by the police, I had a firearm down my pants, and I landed on something called house arrest. A blessing in disguise, which I later found out. Someone watching over me for sure. What happened is I landed myself on house arrest. I served 1 week in something called, punishment unit, okay? But they kept me there to keep me sort of monitored because I had mental issues. They kept me there. It was a horrible experience. I had to clean my cell twice a day. There was 10 guards that would come in. It was very militant. Did I learn my lesson yet? No, I got landed myself on house arrest, fell back into the drug use, fell back into the gang activity. And put on a lot of weight, got really fat and depressed, okay? I couldn't leave my house for 18 months. But in that time, I had enough. I had enough of being really, really obese and really depressed. And I was looking online for the best diet to lose weight. And I come across a raw foodist YouTuber who was talking about the power of fruits and vegetables, and he was doing a juice fasting. And, you know, he sounded like a bit of a hippie to me at that stage. It was a lot different to the demographic I'm used to. But what he said kind of made sense, some of what he said. But one thing that he said stayed with me, and it was very significant, it planted a very powerful seed in my mind. He said, when you eat plant foods, the fruits and vegetables, you're eating the life-giving plants. You know, they contain the water, the nutrients, the phytochemicals, everything your body needs. When you eat dead food, okay, like the piece of a body of an animal who didn't want to die, you're eating everything that animal went through, their fear, their anxiety in their last moments, and they're decomposing. And that manifests as disease and anxiety and fear in you. He planted a seed in my mind. Okay? Now, did that seed flourish into going vegan, changing my life around straight away? No, that's not how it happens. The point is, it was there. The environment had to be right inside of me for it to flourish. So I stayed on home detention, kept drinking. You know, I did my juice fast, lost a lot of weight. I was mixing vodka in with my juice at that stage. So, I stayed with the gangs, and then I ended up serving my sentence for the firearm. So house arrest, 18 months, served my sentence for the firearm. I had to serve 6 months in prison, maximum security prison at the start. And it was a big wake-up call for me, because this was the first time I'd been sober for 12 years. Okay, 12 years of my life I'd been using some type of substance. I hadn't had a week off. So I had a newfound clarity of mind. And I'm seeing my life with new eyes at this stage. I see my life was just a collection of all the mistakes I've made in my past and it had led me to here. I've seen gang members around me doing 5 years, 10 years, 25 years in prison for something stupid they did one night. And that's where all the gangsters go. It all comes to a head in there. They're all fighting each other. It doesn't end in there. It gets worse. And I didn't want to be there. No one in there was happy. I'd never looked at my life from this new perspective, new bird's eye perspective. This was the biggest epiphany I had. Now, after my 6 months, I was released on something called parole. I had another obstacle to my substance use. I was getting urine tested. So this was another blessing in disguise for me. And this was when the magic happened. I was out the back with my mum. She was smoking some cigarettes. And because of my newfound forced sobriety, I was on my sort of superiority complex saying, "Mum, you know, you've got to give up smoking. That's bad for you." Like I could talk. And she said, "Well, there's a lot of vices people have that they don't change." And then she looked at me with this look. And when she said that, though, like, I reflected inside and I thought, what is it about me that I haven't changed? What is it about me that's been inconsistent? And for the past 6 months, I've been living with this inconsistency, this hypocrisy. Because I'd seen the hypocrisy in claiming to care about some animals, dolphins and dogs and cats, while I had a piece of another animal on my plate. And I remember calling out animal rights activists who were standing up for dolphins but eating chicken sandwiches. I remember saying that. And I'd say, well, at least I could admit that I'm a hypocrite. I was very outspoken at this stage. But when my mum said that to me, I decided that there and then to align my, as everyone does, they align their actions with their beliefs. I couldn't live inconsistent anymore. And the next day I went full vegan. But I had to know a certain few things. I couldn't just go full vegan, like, without knowing where to get my protein from. And I was training religiously twice a day, hours on end. So I needed to know that I had to get my protein from plants. That's a legitimate question. That was one that I had. And then I did a quick Google search. It took me 35 seconds, and I found veganbodybuilders.com, and they're all massive, and they only eat plants, and they're way bigger than me, and that was all I needed. Found out that all 9 essential amino acids are found in plants to begin with, which made sense with filtering our nutrients through the dead body of an animal, which really woke me up. Another thing that really snapped me out of it was heart disease. It's the number one killer. No one really talks about the cause of it, though. 17 million people it kills a year, more than wars and cancer. And it's caused by basically eating too much saturated fat and cholesterol. Okay? Refined oils is another big problem, but mainly saturated fat and cholesterol. Cholesterol is only found in animal foods, saturated fat predominantly. So it's crazy that, you know, these animals are coming back from the grave, haunting people from the grave. You know, you're eating too many of their bodies and, you know, bang, you're gone like that. That really snapped me out of it too. I inundated myself with research. Dr. John McDougall, Dr. Neil Barnard, Dr. McGregor, reading all this science, getting right into it. I was hungry for information. Found out about the environment. Because of my newfound sort of path, my newfound awakening, I felt more connected to nature. I spent a lot of time out in nature. Found out that 91% of Amazon deforestation wasn't because of palm oil, wasn't because of logging for paper. They were logging because of cattle ranching. So they're cutting down the forest to grass feed cattle or to grow soybeans. Not for soy milk or tofu for vegans like some people like to think. They're feeding that soy to livestock. And it really, really woke me up. Wow, look what we're doing to the environment. Species extinction, we like to talk about pest animals, don't we? Oh, it's these pest animals ruining our environment. We wipe out, because of the actions of human beings, we're wiping out 10,000 species every year. Through the actions of us. We like to talk about pest animals a lot, don't we? But another thing was our ocean dead zones. Because of all the animals, they have a massive amount of waste. Tons and tons and tons of waste. Dairy industry, meat industry, egg industry. Tons of waste. It falls into these cesspools. What happens? It leaks out into oceans and streams, into streams and leaks out into the oceans. Nothing can live inside a dead zone. And we get a lot of our oxygen. Nearly 80% of the world's oxygen comes from the ocean. Phytoplankton, marine plants. It's crazy. So, found out all this information, it solidified my view on not wanting to hurt animals. There was many other things, the health and environmental aspects. I could get my protein, I wasn't going to die, so that all that was sorted. And it was time for me to change my life around, leave the gangs. Okay, I think they seen it coming. My Facebook post looked a lot different than they did before I got locked up. So it's sort of talking about, you know, helping animals and peace on earth and all this other stuff. If you go back 6 months before, it was who's coming over to get drunk and... They said, when I went up to talk to them about it, you know, I was a bit nervous about it, and they said, oh, we kind of you lead gangs at that level, it's a little bit more difficult. Obviously, it's a little bit more complicated. Can be a little bit more dangerous. I've had to keep my head down. Okay, I stopped talking to everyone from my past. I didn't get involved in anything to do with that scene anymore. When I said I was out completely. I never have looked back. Okay? I've never talked to anyone that I shouldn't have. Never mixed with any other gangs or done any type of substances. And that was a very smart move and a wise move on my part. Was I safe? I didn't know whether I was safe or not. There's a lot of things that happened in my past that I wasn't sure of. I'd always had alcohol and drugs to use as a crutch. I'd always had my friends to use for support if something, you know, if I felt anxious about something. I had no one. Like, I had my family. I had no one else but myself at that stage in my family. And I was filled with anxiety. Filled with anxiety. I didn't know what was coming next for me. All I knew was I wanted to change my life around. And usually I'd run back to alcohol or something like that, but I stayed sober and it was the best decision I ever made. Okay, staying strong through that year, I was very paranoid. I was suffering a lot of trauma, okay, post-traumatic stress disorder, a lot of trauma from things that I'd done, you know. I felt a lot of guilt, a lot of shame, okay. It was a very harsh time for me, but I worked through it, stayed strong. And in this time, the message of animal rights was galvanizing in me. Something about the injustice to animals really spoke to me, and I don't know where this come from. Something in me just hated the fact that animals were being bullied to an extent that you couldn't imagine. And I had this fire inside of me. I couldn't explain it, but every time I woke up, it was right here in my chest, and it was like it wanted to come out. I remember telling people around me, like, you know, I've got this fire inside of me and I have to spread it. And if anyone else has that fire, never deny yourself your chance to spread it, because that's your purpose and it's calling out to you. Mine was screaming out to me, to the point where I was waking up every single day thinking that I've wasted another day. Okay, I needed to do something right there and then. Now, I wanted to help people. 100% I wanted to help people. I wanted to help them transform their life. I wanted to help them with their mental issues. I felt like I was coming from a place of experience that I could help people. I knew I wanted to help. But why did I choose animals? Okay, I realized something, that they are suffering. Okay, and no one's listening to them. Okay, human beings can voice their pain. Okay, they can write a Facebook status, go and talk to someone about it. If they're getting abused, they can scream out for help in our language and we'll listen. Okay, animals, no one's listening to, except for other vegans and you know. But I realised that the animals are the most vulnerable, defenceless, helpless beings on earth. Okay, and they're getting abused and killed to the tune of an unimaginable number. And I thought that they needed my help the most. Okay, so I answered their calls. Now, what did my friends think of this newfound transformation? I mean, obviously, to do something like I did, completely transform my life and say goodbye to my past, I had to not care about what other people think, because I was getting, you know, I was copying it left, right, and centre. But it was funny, they thought, like, you know, I used to go around with them, you know, we used to, you know, have big punch-ups with human beings and stuff, and they said, well, now you won't even hurt a chicken. And I remember saying to my friend, well, that chicken never did nothing wrong to you or me. Okay, and that's an important thing to remember. These animals are innocent. They've done nothing wrong. Okay, more innocent than, you know, the majority of us out here. So, now, I want to preemptively say, any non-vegans in the crowd, that do I think non-vegans are bad people? Not at all. You know, who am I to stand up here and judge? You know, that's why I tell my story, so people know that I'm not coming from a place of judgment. Who am I to be superior? Obviously, probably had a, you know, probably made a lot more mistakes than anyone here. Okay? I used to eat animals more than anyone else here, probably. Massive steaks every night, chickens for breakfast, and everything. So, I'm not here to judge anyone, but I do want to educate people and just speak from a place of truth, and that's all I'm here to do, speak for animals. I'm going to try to play something for you, for those of you who aren't vegan already. Those of you who are vegan, you know, this is all just UK footage of what happens to animals here. It only goes for 5 minutes. I think it's an important point to check before I go into the next part of the talk. Can you hit the lights, please, Doug? Thank you. get away with it that easy, mate.
Hours later, this new mother is repeating the events, along with other cows and even tiny calves.
range, eh? One of those birds with free range. Okay. So, just give people an idea of what we're talking about here in England. This is in the last two, here in the UK, sorry, last 2 years. Everyone likes to pick out the most humane farm on earth, get the farmer from that farm to be an advocate for on behalf of all farms in the UK. It's just ridiculous. It's ridiculous. 99% of animals are factory farmed. Okay, the other 1% go to exactly the same slaughterhouse as all the rest of the animals. Alright, so don't let them try to trick you into thinking that these animals, even on the high welfare farms, are treated any better than these, because in the slaughterhouse they all get treated exactly the same. So we kill around 70, at the moment it's 74 billion, okay? It's not 56 billion anymore, 74 billion land animals for consumption every year, okay? That's just land animals. All animals are essentially children when they're killed, okay? No animal reaches their lifespan, so to end an animal's life a fraction of their age is an injustice in itself. Baby pigs, piglets, if they don't grow fast enough, their heads are smashed on the ground with blunt force trauma. This is a welfare standard too. So if they don't grow fast enough, sometimes they're a bit sick or they're just, you know, they don't grow fast enough. Bang, they're not viable for the industry. They kill them with, they can hit them with a pole too. Welfare standard. Chickens, full grown age, they're 42 days old. Okay, 6 weeks old. And through selective breeding, their bodies are just, you know, overgrown. Okay, they should still be nestling under their mother's wing. They're essentially baby chicks. So if you've ever done a vigil with chickens, they just look like little chicks, you know, but they're just overgrown bodies. We've created these freak shows in labs like out of these animals. It's horrible. Talk about egg slavery. So egg laying hens will be exploited for 18 months, and then they'll, guess what happens to them? Bang, straight to the same slaughterhouse as all the rest of the animals. None of these animals get out alive. They kill all the male chicks. They blend them up in something called a macerator, or they put them in a gas chamber or stick them in a garbage bag and tie it shut, suffocate them. All male chicks in the organic, free-range, barn-raised, all of them, all the male chicks are destroyed. Okay, they're all destroyed. No matter what they try to tell you, they're all destroyed. Even backyard hens industry, okay? Backyard hens, backyard hens. Where do you think all the male chicks go? They're all destroyed, okay? People try to tell you backyard hens are any better? No, that's an industry within itself. Okay, it's a new industry. It's becoming more popular, but the same ethical inconsistencies apply. Free range. We just seen free range birds anyway. But let's just say, like, even though we just seen free range birds and you've seen some of the free range conditions that they still house thousands in a shed, let's just say they were like, you know, how they look like on the package, you know, green pastures and stuff like that. They still will go to the same slaughterhouse, free range or not. Okay, even if they're in this beautiful farm, that are, you know, they do exist, but it's the exception, not the rule. The killing of 1-day-old bobby calves, which is a welfare standard. You know, you can also hit them in the head with a blunt object, but it has to be within 24 hours of them being born. So as long as they're 24 hours old, you can kill them like that. But that's just guidelines. That's just the guideline. So, fish. I want to talk about fish because they're like the most underrepresented animal, even in the animal rights movement. So, 2 to 2.7 trillion marine animals are torn out of the ocean, suffocated, stabbed, poured onto a boat, okay, suffocate under all their family and friends. And must be a horrible thing to face. 40% of that is discarded as bycatch, okay? That can include whales and sharks and whatever they catch, turtles. So that means you just throw it back into the ocean, like that. I want to talk to you a little about fish intelligence. They did something called the coloured plate experiment. Anyone heard of the coloured plate experiment? Okay, so they had a couple of control groups, one with primates, so chimpanzees and stuff. The other one had fish, so we're talking fish that people eat, trout and stuff like that. Okay, and they had two plates, both with food on there. Okay, the animals had to learn how to eat off one coloured plate first, or the other plate would be removed. So if they ate off the red plate, both plates would stay. If they ate off the yellow plate, one plate would disappear. They had to learn this behaviour. Now, the fish bet the primates at this experiment. So the scientist enlisted the help of his 4-year-old daughter, and the fish bet her too. So we're undermining fish intelligence. We talk about collaborative hunting. Interesting thing, you see a little puffer fish enlist the help of an electric eel or an eel. Okay, the eel will tap the puffer fish. The puffer fish does a little dance. The eel taps the nose of the puffer fish. Okay, and they just it's like a contract. Okay, where they'll hunt collaboratively. Okay, and the eel will fish out some other little fish that the puffer fish can't get to. So that they're interspecies collaboratively hunting in the ocean. This is how intelligent fish are. They also have extra senses that we don't possess, something called lateral lines, where when they swim through the ocean, they create a wake in the water. The water repels off rocks and other things in the ocean and other fish, and they can see without their eyes. Now, does that mean that fish are more intelligent than us? We can't do that, can we? Or does that mean we shouldn't compare our intelligences because we're so different? All right. So this is where human beings get it wrong, and we get all superior, thinking that because we don't have the same type of intelligence, our intelligence is somehow superior. But we can't fly, can we? Does that mean birds are more intelligent than us? So even if animals weren't intelligent, still wouldn't justify doing what we do to them. Okay? Because if a human being's not intelligent, that wouldn't justify injustice towards someone with a mental disability, would it? Okay? So intelligence does not determine moral value. Sentience does, okay? Whether you're sentient, whether you feel pain, whether you want to live, okay? All right, so I want to talk about getting to the vegan activism side of it now, because it's important to know what happens to animals, but it's more important to speak up and help, and that's when we really start to help animals. Being vegan just doesn't hurt animals. Being an activist helps them. So the most important thing is knowing why. You have to know why you're doing this. For me, it's the animals, seeing what they go through every single day. It hurts my heart, and I try my best to give back. For you, it might be the environment, but for me, it's the sentient beings that are being victimized. The second most important thing is being educated. You don't have to be as educated as Gary Yourofsky, but it's very powerful to me. You just need a base level understanding of what goes on in each industry, base level understanding of what's happening in the environment. You need to know more than the average person who isn't vegan, because people are going to have questions, okay? When you start challenging people's belief systems, they're going to have questions. And there's answers to all these questions, so don't worry about that. You have the truth on your side. We have a lot of mountain of evidence to support our... These aren't just baseless claims, okay? We have a mountain of evidence. Okay, I want to talk to you a little bit about my activism journey. Who used to watch my older videos? Yeah, there's a couple here. Luckily, okay. Hidden all those videos. I used to be a bit aggressive in my videos because of obviously the past I came from. I was learning to reintegrate, and I was still having trouble. I still had some personality traits that I was trying to work through, and I was pretty pissed off about what was going on with animals. I didn't like it. I hated seeing them get abused and bullied, and I was trying to defend them and stick up for them in the way that I thought was best. And in retrospect, it wasn't the most effective way. Even though my heart was in the right place, I was letting aggression run the party, and it's not an effective way to communicate, and I learned that. I've learned that now, and now I reach many more people. Many more people, and, I feel like I'm changing a lot more people too, because less people have their guard up. So that was an important lesson for me, angry activism. Now, am I perfect? No, I still get angry every now and then. I'm a human being, okay? What's happening to animals gets to me every single day. When someone does something insensitive, and says something really insensitive, I every now and then, I react. But we'll get into that. Now, I found talking to people like they're your friend is the best way to communicate with someone, okay? They're not your enemy, it's not us against them. We haven't all been vegan our whole lives. I know sometimes when you first go vegan, you think you've been vegan your whole life, you forget that you used to eat steak just as much as everyone else. And it's a good thing to remind yourself of, because then you can talk to people on their level instead of thinking, instead of appearing like you're somehow above them, because you might not even be trying to do that. But sometimes you can come across like you're trying to be superior. That's why I always let people know my past, or that I used to eat animals too, and it brings me back down a notch. So they feel like, okay, well, he's no better than me, which I'm not. So, what's the most effective form of activism? Who knows? Anyone know? Okay, I'll tell you. Rarely someone puts their hand up for this. The most effective form of activism is the one that you're best at. Okay, so that's different. We're all very diverse in our skill set. Okay, so that's the good thing about having diversity is we're all good at something. Okay, now you don't get the person who's good at cooking to come out and do public speeches. You don't get the person who's good at organising to go out and do, you know, debates with farmers, or, you know, you don't get the person who's good at whatever your skill set is. Utilise that in the movement. All right. And that's the most effective form of activism for you, all right? There's many different things you can do. You don't have to do what I do. Do what comes best and resonates with you. So don't be afraid of the word activism. Okay, now, understanding the person you're talking to, I'm going to get into why making videos is so effective. So anyone know who Gary Yourofsky is? Vegans will probably all know what Gary Yourofsky is. Okay, now Gary Yourofsky was a public speaker, spoke in universities, the educator of educators on this topic. Now he did around 2,000 speeches to around 50,000 students throughout his career, and one person filmed his Georgia Tech speech, okay, in the crowd. It wasn't even him. He didn't even know about it. They put it up on YouTube, okay, it's reached millions now. Millions, okay, he's gone viral, he's world famous now because of social media and video making. Now, how long would it have taken him to reach that many people if it was just, you know, it would have taken him 100 more lifetimes and 100 more Gary Yourofskys. But that's the power of making videos, okay? That's why a lot of my reach is from making videos. So that's what I've found to be very effective at reaching people. And, you know, if that resonates with you, if you like making videos, you don't even have to be in the video. You could just be good at editing and chopping together and put them up out there. That's how you reach lots of people, and that's why this movement is skyrocketing at the moment. Okay, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about Anonymous for the Voiceless. Who knows Anonymous for the Voiceless? Okay, that's good. I'm going to give you some outreach tips. Basically, Anonymous for the Voiceless, for people who don't know, is you get a group of people to stand in a queue formation. They show current slaughterhouse or abattoir or farm footage. Okay, it has to be current, it has to be local. All right, because people just go, oh, that's happening in Mexico in the 1980s, that's not happening now. So no, we want it to be current, we want it to be local. And there's plenty of current UK footage. A Land of Hope and Glory's got plenty of that footage if you need it. But I'll give you some outreach tips. Vegan outreach is just basically having a conversation with people. Okay, positive conversation, polite discussion, a respectful discussion. First thing you need to know is building rapport. So building rapport basically is, it's basic sales techniques, and I was doing this without really knowing, and you probably do it without really knowing too, but I just had to analyse my own behaviour so I could present it to you guys. But basically, is you see someone, they walk up to you, okay, what sort of person are they like? Are they this type of person? You know, what's their behaviour? How are they talking? What's their body language? You kind of mimic that, okay? If someone's really softly spoken, and maybe an elderly person, you don't walk up and go, oh my God, you should see... You know, you're not talking to them on their level. So you try to analyse the person you're speaking to. Like, if it's a 15-year-old guy with a bunch of his mates, pretty cool and that, you know, you don't talk down to them like you're their teacher. You speak to them on their level. How you gone, bro? Have you seen this before, mate? You know, speak to them, like, on their level. If they're dropping a few swear words here and there, sometimes I do, and they go, wow, he's like me, you know, this guy's pretty cool. So it's not, like, rocket science or anything like that. You probably do it in your day-to-day life anyway, but you have to be really aware of that, especially when communicating with people. And building rapport is a massive tip. It really is. Always have info and resources on you if you're just every day. I always have them on me. We have about 1,000 cards at the moment that we just got printed. And on the cards, they're very concise, okay? So if you give someone a pamphlet with 10,000 words on it on something that they're not really interested in, they're probably not going to read it. I'm interested in it, and I probably won't read it myself. So you have to be, I reckon it's better to be concise, you know, three or four, you know, links. If you get them to watch one link, that's got more information than any pamphlet could ever have on it. So if you've just got them to watch one video, then you're on a winner there. So ethics in this country is landofhopeandglory.org, okay? That's all current, all high welfare, RSPCA approved, red tractor approved, farms, barn raised, all of that stuff is in there. Okay, health, What the Health, What the Health film, because you go to the website and all the facts are linked with sources, okay, and the sources are peer-reviewed journals from science, so they're from scientists, the scientific literature. So if they want to say, oh, that's vegan propaganda, okay, we'll go into the scientific literature and refute the science, because those scientists that did that study, they're not all vegan, so how could it be biased? So Cowspiracy as well. Okay, Cowspiracy for Environment. I always have that there because you can go to the website Cowspiracy Facts. Okay, and these facts that I'm listing when I talk about the environment are all on their website with sources. Okay, so it's not just people making claims, like someone from the egg industry making an article saying eggs are healthy, okay, with no backup, with no scientific links, just it's just someone making a declaration, and that's not what we use. Only verifiable with science, okay? And that's what I recommend. Anyway, don't recommend someone an article from a vegan, okay, because that's not, you know, that's not what we're about. We want it to be verifiable. Also, always on your information, when they turn it around, have some type of resource where they can get mentoring to follow plant-based or vegan lifestyle. Okay, you might have your own that you want to use. I use Challenge 22, which is great. There's another one, Veganuary. There's Vegan Easy, do the 30-day challenge too. But somewhere where they can get mentoring, you might have your own group. But always have these on you, not just when you're doing AV type outreach, just every day. Okay, we give them out to everyone. We see nearly, nearly everyone. Okay, so I'll talk to you about the power of showing slaughterhouse footage. There's nothing more powerful than showing someone what happens inside the slaughterhouse, because people have a little picture in their mind they make up, and I don't know where this picture comes from. I don't know. I think it's basically from the propaganda that's perpetuated by industry. Happy farms, from farm to plate. They miss out the big part in between where the cows are getting strung up by their hoof and slashed across their throat. Okay. Now people have this picture in their mind of what slaughterhouses look like, and you need to dispel that myth by going, hey, this is what's actually happening. This is what's happening inside the slaughterhouse. There's nothing really more powerful than that. There's also a small discrepancy with it. Okay, when people see what I just showed you there, they go, oh, those particular farms, you know, yeah, they're pretty bad. Luckily, I get my free-range grass-fed beef from a local butcher down the road that does it really cleanly. My free-range eggs, look at the carton, green pastures, it's all sweet. So you can get in a little bit of a welfarist discussion with them, okay, that it could be done better. Okay, there's a humane way to do this. My farm that I get it from is a very humane, well-treated. The vets go there every day and look after the animals. Okay, these places do exist. Not going to deny that. But the point is, we are using animals. Okay, they do not have a choice in that. We're exploiting them for their bodies. Okay, they are essentially products. Okay, this is the problem, that we're using animals. And slaughterhouses, they're all the same. Basically, they're all the same. Bolt gun in the head, knife across the throat, that's where it ends. There's no humane way to take an animal's life, okay, against their will. So if you do get in this little welfarist cruelty discussion by showing someone animal cruelty footage, it's up to the person on outreach to bring it away from animal cruelty, away from animal welfare, to animal use, because that's where it ends. We shouldn't be using them at all. Okay, we shouldn't be killing them at all. Okay. Be aware of that. Be aware of that, because obviously, this is what the industry are holding on to. We treat our animals well on this particular farm, okay? But what happens inside the slaughterhouse? Show us that. How come you're holding all that information from us? You say you're transparent. Show us what goes on inside that slaughterhouse. I've been inside the slaughterhouse, and cameras are left inside there all the time, okay? Why don't they just televise what's going on inside the slaughterhouse and before the burger commercial? Okay, so always remain polite and respectful, and I've got written here calm, but sometimes it doesn't call to be calm, you know. Sometimes the conversation can be risen a bit. And I think sometimes matching the people you're in conversation with can help. But polite and respectful. Now, like I said, I don't always adhere to this like myself, because sometimes, you know, I've had a rough week. I've seen a lot of, you know, animal cruelty, and, I can get worked up myself. But, you know, as much as you really want to, try your best to control yourself. I mean, I did a radio interview the other day, and I've probably got to let that get a little bit heated, a bit more than I should have, in retrospect, but, you know, only a human being, and, you know, I've got plenty of time to redeem myself. So try your best. Always remain respectful, though. I never swear, even no matter how, you know, pissed I get. I never swear at someone. I never call them a name, okay? I'm always just using, you know, truthful things, but, you know, don't let your emotion run the conversation. That's an important point. Now, you don't have to respect someone's actions, but you should show them respect, okay? Because it was a time when you didn't know. Now, I'd never ask anyone to respect someone's choice to buy products that are killing innocent beings. I wouldn't ask you to do that, but you should show them respect, okay? Which I always do, and I tell people, yeah, I respect you, but I don't respect your decision to do this because it's hurting my friends, all right? And remember this, that everyone you talk to is unique, okay? Now, you need to hit that person where the conversation is going. Some people are empaths. You show them something like that, they get really upset, okay, and you know, they feel for animals, okay? So you need to keep that in their emotion. I had a vigil with Devon Cowsave, and it was a farmer who was dropping his cow off at the slaughterhouse, and he didn't like her. He was, you know, he must have been quite emotional about it. He didn't want to stop his truck. He just drove straight through us. We only wanted a couple minutes, but he turned around, dropped the cow off, come back and talked to us. And he said, "You guys are making this harder for me than it already is." All right, so this is a guy, a farmer, who really cared for his cows. You know, they come to him every morning, he feeds them. Genuinely cares for his cows. All right, I wouldn't dispute that. Okay, he did. He was upset. And I said, "You know, you don't have to do this. You don't have to do this. You know, there is other ways to make a living. You don't have to kill, you know, your cows." Anyway, I had him in emotion. And someone over my shoulder started bringing it into statistics on, you know, how much food it takes to grow a cow and, you know, the water use and stuff. But anyway, I took it out of his heart and started bringing it into his logic, which that's not where I wanted to take it. So I told him to excuse me and let me handle the conversation. Because when you've got it in their emotion, that's where you keep it. That's where it's going. Now, you can have a logical debate on this topic till you know, forever. Because you can win argument on veganism on pure logic alone. You don't have to bring emotion into it, okay? Because it's an illogical position. There's so many contradictions with eating animals, okay? You claim to care for some, you're eating others, okay? You want to live in peace and harmony yourself, you're condemning others to a slaughterhouse who want to live just as much as you. There's so many contradictions. It's an illogical position. You don't have to bring emotion into it, but I always try to. Because you get someone to, you know, to express emotion, and you get it to be altruistic. You get it to think about others and not themselves. Okay, and this is how we create a better world. So if you can, there's anonymous for the voiceless here. Belfast AB, is it? Belfast AB. Get in touch with Clifford. Join anonymous. It's a great outlet for you. You know, some people that, you know, friends and family, they don't want to hear about this. But this gives you a really good, you know, you've exhausted your options with them. You can go out to do AB and you can have a really positive discussion with someone who's stopped at the screens and wants to have a conversation about it. It's really fulfilling, and I really recommend it, okay? It gives you a great outlet. Talk to you a little bit about Socratic method. So anyone know who Socrates is? Socrates, I didn't know who he was till someone told me that I was doing Socratic method. So basically a Greek philosopher who teaches people by asking questions. It's the least intrusive way of educating someone. I feel like it's much more powerful and effective than just pumping information down someone's throat, because it takes 1 second for them to switch off. Okay, they switch off really quickly, and then they've lost you for the whole conversation. They're just looking at you, looking past you, waiting for you to finish talking. But if you ask them a question, bang, they go, "Oh, boy, they just asked me a question. I've got to respond. I've got to think about the answer, and then I'll respond." Now, you keep questioning them through the contradictions, okay? And you can see their conditioning unravel before your eyes, okay? So you care about animals? Yes? Yeah, I care about animals. Okay, what animals? You got a dog at home? Yes, I've got a dog at home. Okay, does your dog want to live, feel pain, suffer, they get hungry, tired, you know, they have feel emotions? Yes. Okay, so what difference is your dog to a pig? I don't know, pigs are food, aren't they? Okay, who taught you pigs are food? You learned that? Did you learn that from, is that something you already knew, or is that something you learned? So you're questioning through their conditioning, okay? And you can say, okay, do you think a pig wants to die, doesn't want to die just as much as your dog doesn't want to die? So you just keep navigating them through their logic, and if they say, you know, whatever they say, just answer back with a question. And it diffuses arguments, okay? It brings everything back down because it gets them to think, okay? And it's the least intrusive way of educating someone. Just do it, try it, and you'll become really good at it. Try and have a whole conversation with someone where you don't even make a statement, you're just asking questions, okay? And see how it goes. Also, something that I could have taken a bit of advice from this week is how to stay calm when someone says something hurtful. If you respond, you don't react, okay? So you can have a knee-jerk reaction to your emotion, okay? You let your emotion take the conversation. And, you know, the reality is when you let emotion ride the conversation, it's not really going to turn out that well. It can turn a debate, discussion into an argument. You don't really want that. You want to respond, okay? You don't react. And when you respond, respond with a question. That would be my best advice I could give you. Okay, I'll talk to you about the SAVE movement. Who's been a part of the SAVE movement here? Okay. Alright. So the SAVE... Who doesn't know what the SAVE movement is? Okay. The SAVE movement is a massive worldwide movement where we stand at the front of slaughterhouses, okay, and we stop trucks before they go in and we bear witness to the animals before they're slaughtered, okay? It is single-handedly the most powerful form of activism I've ever done. When I started bearing witness, everything changed. Okay, I started to meet the animals that I'm fighting for. Okay, seeing how they're all individuals with individual personalities. Every animal on that truck handles the situation a lot differently. Some are still kind of happy. Some are really depressed and sad and have a really hard time. Maybe they've chewed the front of their legs because they've been in a sow stall. Sow mothers, so mother pigs that have had their piglets taken off them their whole life, had their bodies exploited, and then they're on the way to a slaughterhouse. That's the only way out for them is getting killed. Chickens dying on the way to slaughter, broken legs because they can't support their own weight, broken wings because they've been chucked in the back of trucks, feces and urine all over them, all right? Now, you look into the animal's eyes and you realize in that moment that it's not about me, okay? This is who it's about right here. Something overcomes you, and it really gives you the conviction to fight harder. I recommend if you're a vegan, that you do it at least once, or you know, get involved with bearing witness. And you might say, well, I just can't do that, Joey, it's too hard for me. Like I said, when you see the animals, something overcomes you and you get strength. Okay? You realise that they're the ones who are the victims, and that small bit of anxiety you might have, you realise it gives you perspective, okay? Compared to what they're going through, it's nothing. It really is nothing. Also, it builds solidarity. Okay, it brings us together because we realise when we're standing out the front there that, okay, we're all in this together and this is what we're fighting for, these animals here. Now, we got free-range animals in the back of those trucks, yep. We got factory-farmed animals in the back of those trucks. We got humane welfare standard RSPCA-approved animals on the back of the same trucks, all going to the same place. So, and, you know, you can stand out the front of the gas chamber and hear the pigs screaming for mercy, all right? Now I speak for animals on a different level, okay? The conviction in my voice, you can hear it, okay? And they will hear it. When you go out and do some type of vegan outreach after that, they can really hear it in your voice, okay? Because you've been there with them, okay? You've suffered with them. Also, people might say standing out front of the slaughterhouse does nothing for animals. You're just, you know, standing out there with a sign getting yelled at, and you know, people just look ridiculous, which is nothing. It's anything further from the truth. Okay? Now, it does everything. Now, the SAVE movement, the reason it's so powerful is because these days we have something called, you know, iPhones. Okay? And they're like a little window to an audience. Okay? And enough of us with these phones creates a bigger audience. So how are you going to get 50,000 people out to a slaughterhouse? You can't even get someone to come to a non-vegan restaurant, to a vegan restaurant with you. But you can with these iPhones. So if you've got, you know, 50 people each with 1,000 friends, bang, you've essentially reached, potentially, 50,000 people. Now, if you've got a SAVE group in every city, in every country on earth, how many people are you reaching? You know, you're showing people that their food had a face, didn't want to die, okay? And this is very powerful, nearly as powerful as showing slaughterhouse footage. It's a little bit more, you know, G-rated, so, you know, sharing pictures of animals on the way to slaughter, and, you know, it can be very moving for people, and it can really, you know, help them connect the dots between their bacon and that puppy dog-like animal that didn't want to die. Okay, so I'll move into the next bit, but if you want to get involved with the SAVE, I think, is there a SAVE here, Clifford? We did one the other day, but it's...
No, there is a SAVE group in Belfast, but I don't think they've ever done one, so the one we did yesterday was probably one of the first ones that has been in Northern Ireland. Wow. We did one last year at Carlow as well, and they closed the factory down for the day. But that's the first time we've done it since, because we've been focusing on street outreach.
Yeah. So. I recommend getting it together,
yeah.
Getting the SAVE group together, because it's just, the SAVE movement and Anonymous for Voiceless work hand in hand.
Yeah.
Okay, you go and bear witness, then you go tell the public about it. Okay, it's very powerful. And it helps stoke that fire, because you realise, wow, this is really happening. This is happening around the corner. Every second of every single day, right around the corner from you. And you can say, hey, to your friends and family, hey, look, these are the pigs in your local area. Now, these supply Sainsbury's here, that's the pigs that you're potentially eating. Look at their faces. You know, there's nothing more powerful than that. Some activists even go as far as finding the serial number of the slaughterhouse, and it's actually on the, so it's the number that supplies the supermarket will have the number of the slaughterhouse, so you can say, okay, this dead animal here come from this slaughterhouse here where we did this vigil here, and this is what they look like when they're alive. So it's even more powerful. Really powerful to show someone that, because people pick up a dead bird from the supermarket and put it in their trolley, and I go to them, you know, there's a dead bird in your trolley. And they go, where, what? And I go, right there. I point at their turkey, and they go, oh, wow, I never even thought of that. Okay, and I love animals. Okay, they didn't realise that it's a dead bird. They're just that conditioned to see it as like some type of food product. They don't realise that it's a dead bird. So helping people connect the dots, waking them up. Okay, I want to talk about why I believe, and no one can change my mind on this, why I believe it's an obligation to be active. And by active, I mean proactive. So don't get scared off by the word activism. Like I said before, we're all diverse. We can all bring something to the movement. It's about being proactive in whatever positive way resonates with you. But I'll tell you why. Veganism is the first, is the starting point. So anyone who's not yet vegan, vegan is the starting point. Veganism means it's a neutral position. It means you've been causing immense suffering with your actions and you've decided to stop. Okay? You've been causing harm, now you've stopped. Okay? That's the first step. It's a neutral position, and if anyone knows about neutral positions, Martin Luther King said it best, if you're neutral in times of injustice, you've chosen the side of the oppressor. So if it was any other form of injustice, okay, if you've seen someone beating their spouse, if you've seen someone abusing a child, kicking a dog on the side of the road, you would do something. You would intervene, okay? And if you didn't, what would society say to you, okay? Now, why is that any different for farmed animals? If you are vegan, you're vegan for a reason, okay? You know what happens to animals, okay? You know what's happening to the environment. You know basically what's happening. So if you stand by and remain silent, okay, there comes a time when silence is betrayal. So if you remain silent in an opportunity, you have to speak about this. And I'm not telling you to be rude. I'm not asking you to be rude. I'm asking you can do this in a very polite, tactful way. But if you remain silent, you basically betrayed those animals that you know what's going on with them. And if we don't do this, no one else is going to do it because no one else knows. The obligation isn't with those people because they don't know. If you knew of a child being abused, you know. Someone who doesn't know does not have the obligation to speak up about it. It's the ones who know about it. Animals would save themselves if they could, but they can't. They are helpless. Okay? They are helpless. The only time a cow ever gets violent is when they're having their calves stolen from them. Okay? And they do fight the first couple of times. They do fight, but after the third or fourth time, they just stop fighting. Okay? Suffer maternal trauma and that's it. But they would save themselves if they could. If we don't speak up, no one's going to. And I want to release some of the burden that you might have from this, and that's that some people feel like they, when they first become, you know, vocal about this, that they have to turn someone vegan, first conversation they have with them 100% vegan bang, otherwise they're a bad activist or something like that. This is what I used to do to myself. Oh my God, I've tried everything. I've tried getting to watch Earthlings, tried to get them to watch Cowspiracy, told them everything about health and they still haven't gone vegan. And why, Mum, why haven't you gone vegan yet? But our job isn't to turn everyone vegan, okay? That's not your responsibility, okay? Your job is to plant seeds. I want to tell you a little bit something about the 100-point system, okay? The 100-point system was developed by my activist friend Omri Paz from Israel, and he heads an organization called Vegan Friendly. Israel is one of the most vegan countries on earth, okay? So the activists there are really doing their part for the animals. Now, it goes like this. You might be having a conversation with someone about the dairy industry, bang, you've just dropped 20 points in their mind. They walk off. That's the first conversation they've ever had about veganism. Bang, 20 points. Off they go. They're searching through their phone on Facebook. Bang, something comes up about the egg industry. Okay, male chicks being macerated. Okay, that's another 30 points. Bang, essentially they're up to 50 points. They might be recommended What the Hell movie. They watch it. 35 points. Bang, they're up to 85 points. Then they're walking down the street. They see an AV. One of you guys have just gone bear witness. You see this person coming. Bang, you start talking to them about the pigs that you're seeing on the way to the gas chamber. You give them the last 15 points. Okay? Now you might think, oh wow, I turned that person vegan right there on the spot. I'm a magician. But that might be true. That might be true. But the reality is, they probably heard about this and been thinking about this before they seen you. So you might be the first 20 points to get them started, or you might be that last 15 points to finish them off. But very rarely are you that full 100 points. Okay? So that's all you got to remember. You got to be like a gardener, planting seeds and shining your light wherever you go. Okay? If you have a really good conversation with someone, you can give someone the most golden information on earth. Okay? and they don't change. You've done your part. You need to move on to the next person. I'll tell you there's something that probably the 1% of the population is vegan, okay? And 1% of that 1% are active. Okay, so who comes to the UK march in England? From Ireland? Did you went? Wow. Wow. It'd be good to get everyone to fly over, okay, for this year's march. It's August 25th. Okay, come down. We need to get everyone there. So we had about 5,000 people marching through the streets, okay, London streets. They shut down London streets. It was amazing, okay. And we weren't marching for just one animal, dolphins, or, you know, marching for, you know, Yulin China. No, this was a vegan march, marching for all animals, okay, screaming for animal liberation. And people were looking out through the windows, and wow, it was an amazing feeling. Imagine if we got 2% out. So 500,000 vegans in the UK, 500,000. We got 5,000 out, that's 1%. Okay, imagine if we got 10,000. Imagine if we got the whole 1% out. That would be crazy.
The year before there was only 2,500.
Wow, so it's multiplied. But there was still, the point is, the vegans are there. The vegans were already there. It's just how many you want to get come out and, you know, and just walk with us. Just walk, just show the numbers. Stand up. I want to give you some thoughts on courage, because some people think that I've just always had this courage to do what I do, to get up and publicly speak, to get up and, you know, have these things at the front of slaughterhouses, have these debates, and no. So courage isn't something you're just born with, it's something you build on and you work on, okay? It's something that comes from gradually stepping outside of your comfort zone and speaking up, okay? So your comfort zone might be really, really small, which mine used to be, really small, and you can just stick your little toe out, okay? And then you've done, you've stepped outside your comfort zone. Next time you step out a little bit further. Mine's a little bit bigger now, but I can still step outside of that, and I still do. I still do things that I'm uncomfortable with. And courage is about feeling the fear and doing it anyway. So you might not, I don't want to go bear witness, or I feel a little bit anxious about it. It's more comfortable for me to stay at home. Nothing amazing ever happens inside your comfort zone, does it? Okay? If you let fear run your life, I would have never got to where I am now. Never. Okay? If I always let fear run my life. Now, the animals need you now. Okay? The earth needs you now. Not when you decide to build confidence in the next year. Now. Okay? So, stepping outside your comfort zone, and it's the most liberating feeling in the world. You really will surprise yourself. Nothing feels better. Really, really amazing. So, also, the longer you're vegan, the longer you're an activist, you can lose hope. Okay, you can lose hope. You focus on the magnitude of what's happening to animals, the sheer number alone. Billions a week, you know, billions of wheat tortured, slaughtered, ripped out in the ocean, suffocated, stabbed constantly, every second of every day. Focusing on that constantly, and you don't see it changing fast enough, you can lose hope, okay? And sometimes activists, they do, vegans, they might do some activism that's not fulfilling. They might be getting yelled at, and, you know, their family don't understand. It can really get people down, really get people down. But what I do is I focus on the exponential growth of the movement. Okay, I've been vegan for 4 years now. I've been predominantly active for the last 2 years. Even in the last 1 year, okay, there was a 987% increase in meat-free alternatives in the UK alone last year. Okay, that's nearly a 1,000% increase. Okay, there's vegan restaurants are bringing out vegan alternatives here, left, right, and centre. The fast food chains are working it out. All right, the demand for vegan products is getting higher because there's more vegans, okay? There's been an exponential growth. Now, there used to be one Gary Roski, one predominant activist. Now there's about 20,000. They're just everywhere. And there's predominant animal rights movement is just gone viral worldwide, okay? So we all marched in Israel last year for the biggest animal rights march ever. There was 25 to 30,000 people marching through the streets of Israel. It was huge, massive. Okay, you should have seen what it looked like from the sky. Now, this wasn't happening 4 years ago. Okay, it's happening now, just recently in the last week. Okay, televised all over the newspapers. I mean, it hasn't always been good publicity. But the point is they're starting to listen. They're starting to listen. And you can tell that they're getting a bit wary of it because they're trying to discredit a whole peaceful movement by labelling us extremists. Okay, and I'm sure they did this with all the other movements, the black rights movements, with the suffragettes, the women's rights. You know, they probably did that too, label them all extremists. They used to call women's rights activists militant. They used to call them militant, okay? They're doing the same thing with vegans now. Militant, we want peace for animals, okay? So that's what's happening. Okay, it's starting to come into the forefront of the mainstream. There's going to be debates on the news, and we're bringing it to the forefront of debate. Okay, and this is what's happening. This massive change happening. So whenever you start to lose hope, just think of this. This is a very crucial time for us right now. So get involved. Also, I want to talk to you about solidarity, building solidarity, sticking together. We're all in this together. I want to tell you a story about when I was in Bali and I bared witness inside of a halal slaughterhouse. I watched four animals be decapitated in front of my face. It was a very traumatic experience. I watched the animals, the last sort of breath of life drain from their eyes right in front of me. Horrible place. It smells like feces and blood and fear. It doesn't smell like death inside a slaughterhouse. It smells like struggle. Okay, this was a very traumatic experience for me, but in that moment I realized it wasn't about me, it was about those animals. Okay. Now, the point is, I put the video up, and in the comments section, a lot of vegans were getting behind me, saying, hey, Joel, you know, maybe you should have a break. You know, you don't know what can happen. Post-traumatic stress disorder can happen a little bit later on. You might not know how this has affected you. Have a little break. I felt like I was okay. Worked fraud okay. I thought it was pretty full on, but I had a thick skin, and I was all right. But the point is, I had support if I needed it. Okay, and that's what we all got to remember. Not everyone is like you. Sometimes, you know, seeing what's happening to animals every second of every day can really get people down. The family might not understand. They might be doing it really hard. And if you just for you to go, hey, are you all right? Are you doing okay? I've been through that too. Do you want to talk about it? Just that can mean the world to someone. And if we don't stick together, we're already a minority. Okay, the world already, you know, doesn't like the fact that we're challenging their belief systems and trying to help animals. But if you stick together and offer support, we are stronger as a unit together. Okay? Now, we all need to believe that this is possible for it to manifest. I mean, it can seem like, you know, futile, you know, how are we going to change the world? But if we don't believe that it's possible, it will never manifest. I mean, I'm sure anyone who wanted to change the world had an unwavering belief that it's possible, and I do. I do believe this is possible, and that's why I fight so hard. Nelson Mandela said it always seems impossible until it's done, okay? But I think it's very possible. It's happening now. But it'll happen a lot faster if we all get together and do this together. All right? So we all need to stand up now. Okay, so I'm going to leave you with a little quote that always helps me ignite that fire. And it's, the world would not be destroyed by those who do evil, but by those who stand by and watch. So let's get up there and do something. Thank you very much.